Hey family, this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. What a great opportunity it is for us to gather together on this Wednesday night for our Bible study as we begin to dive deeper into Scripture homiletically and theologically for us to be able to understand who God is in our life and even what our responsibility is as we strive to walk closely with God each and every day of our lives. I'm honored to be here with you on tonight as your pastor, as we prepare to go into Scripture. Let's start with a word of prayer. Father, we are so thankful for this day. Thank you for being God over our lives, in our lives, and in every step, every journey that we find ourselves on. I pray, God, that you will continue to give us the grace we need to walk with you boldly and to be all that you have called us to be. It is in Jesus' name we pray and we say amen. All right, tonight we're going to go into what I would like to look at as a concept of us renewing our mind. That's maybe we can call this these series that we're going to be looking at for the next couple of weeks. Dealing with renewing our mind. Our scripture focus is going to be 2 Corinthians chapter number 10. And for the sake of time, we're just going to read one verse. And then we'll begin to walk to that as an introduction and make our way to where we want to get to. So we're talking about renewing our mind. 2 Corinthians chapter number 10, verse number 4. Here's what it says: for the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. Yeah, let me say it again. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments in every opinion, lofty opinion raised against us in the knowledge of God, and we take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ, being ready to punish every disobedience when your obedience is complete. All right, so we want to talk about this whole concept of renewing the mind, right? So the first step to a renewed mind is for us to understand the covenant of grace. Let's start there. If we're going to have a renewed mind, if we're going to understand what a renewed mind looks like, we first have to understand the covenant of grace. Grace is the covenant between God and humanity that was established by Jesus Christ. All right. Now, understand, we are just leaving out of Holy Week. So we've been hearing sermons all week about what Jesus did and how he paid the price, how Jesus Christ is a part of the atonement of our sins. He was the sacrificial lamb. He was the substitutionary atonement. We learned that, right? Substitutionary atonement, also vicarious atonement. It is when Jesus steps in the place of us and takes on our sins, covers us in the midst of our transgressions and our iniquities. He steps in the place, paid the price for our sins. So we understand what that looks like, right? So we must understand that Jesus has already given and provided for us everything that we need, right? Grace is, when we look at the concept of grace, grace is a person and not a work. Let me let that sit there for a moment. Grace is a person and not a work. It's not a work of action. It is a person. Jesus is grace. The Bible says that he is full of what? Grace and full of truth. So when we look at this concept of grace, We must understand that Jesus Christ, because he's grace, he has already given us and provided us with everything we need for the journey of life. Ephesians 2:8-9 says it this way: "For by grace you have been saved through faith." Let me say it again. "For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not of your own doing," but what does it say? "It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that any man can boast." So when Paul speaks of the gift of God, he's speaking of Jesus. All right, don't miss that. When he speaks of the gift of God, he speaks of Jesus. Because why? John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave," here is the gift of grace, "he gave his only," who? "Begotten Son." So when Jesus died on the cross and said that it is finished, that's exactly what he meant. The work was finished, and so we must move and operate in a place that allows us to accept the finished work of Jesus Christ. All right? Let me give another scripture. Romans 6:14 says, "For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under the law," but who? Under what? "Under grace." So again, grace is a person. So when we begin to understand the reality of who Jesus is, what he has done, our mindset changes, because we understand the whole concept of the covenant of grace. When you understand the covenant of grace and what and who Jesus is and what he's done on Calvary, now you begin to move and speak at a different level and a different capacity. I no longer say I am waiting to be blessed because of what Jesus has done. I'm already blessed. Are you with me? My mindset changes. I'm no longer waiting to be healed. I'm already healed. By his stripes, what? We are healed, right? I'm no longer waiting to be delivered. I'm already delivered. So whatever you think or whatever you are waiting for God to do, the good news is he's already done it. And so many times as Christians, we get into this religious mindset or this religious thinking that we have to work or do something in order for God to do something for us. That is a sense of religiosity where you begin to feel as though that in order for God to do something for me in my life, I have to, in fact, do something for him. And until we change that mindset about Jesus and what he has done, we will never fully, truly experience or enjoy what he has already done. You don't have to do anything. Jesus has already done it. So let me help you. Small shifts in our thinking and small changes in our emotional state can lead to massive alterations in our results. Let me say it again. Small shifts in our thinking and small changes in our emotional state can lead to massive alterations in our results. What do you mean, Paz? If you can change your mind, you can change your life. Let me say it again. If you can change your mind, change your thinking about something, you can change your life. All you're doing is programming your mind. The key to success is overcoming your self-limiting beliefs and arranging yourself with the energy you want in your life. You've got to align yourself up with what you are expecting to happen in your life. You can truly be, you can truly do, and you can truly have all that God wants you to have if you're willing to change your thinking. Let's look at this. Titus chapter 2, verse number 12 says, and it teaches us, it says, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Why are you telling me that scripture, Pastor? Because I want you to understand, going back to grace, grace doesn't change you, but it's grace that won't leave you while you're in the process of going through your change. I'm trying to help us to understand that there are some areas in your life that God already knows you're struggling with, you're dealing with, you're trying to get over, you got some bad habits you're trying to break. God already knows all of that. That's why he's there. That's why he stands there as grace. Okay? Let me give you the scripture. Paul goes and prays three times, Lord, remove the thorn. And three times he prays, Lord, remove the thorn. What is the text that Jesus says? Jesus says, I'm not going to remove the thorn, but my grace, me, I am sufficient for you. In other words, I'm enough to help you get through the areas of your struggles. And many people get it twisted when they get saved, because they either look at grace, watch this, as a license to sin, or they expect grace to do the work and change their behavior for them. Which means getting saved or receiving salvation doesn't automatically changes a person's behavior or even their thinking. You catch that? Just because you give your life to Christ, it doesn't mean that your behavior changes or your thinking changes. Here's why. Because you don't change your life by changing your life. You change your life by changing your mind. That's what I'm trying to get us to understand. We're going to this whole concept of the mind. You don't change your life by just changing your life. You change your life by changing your mind, by refocusing your mind, changing your thinking, realigning your mindset. Romans 12 and 2 backs it up by saying, be not what? Conformed to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. He said, listen, there's going to be a whole lot of patterns. There's going to be a whole lot of things happening in the world around you. There's going to be a whole lot of stuff going on. And if you want, you can in fact live that way. But he's saying you have another opportunity to what? Change your thinking, transform your mind, right? He says these patterns that he's talking about, that they're not just ungodly practices, right? But they're also practices. They are traditions. He said, don't get caught up into the trends of this world. Don't get so caught up in the culture of this world. Don't get caught up in the societal norms, because these ways can lead to an unhealthy and dysfunctional way and even end up leading you to having bad habits. But he says, here's what you do. Get rid. Don't worry about the practices. Don't worry about the traditions, because you know, even in church, we love traditions, right? We love for things to be the same way all the time. And then what we do, we sprinkle it with God and say that it's God. But no, all traditions are not godly. So here's what he's saying. He says, don't get caught up in those practices, those traditions, the trends of the world, the culture, right? Culture changes, societal norms. They would create a certain look. But he says, don't worry about all of that, because those things can lead to bad habits. But what you can do is be transformed by the renewing of your mind. If you want to become a new you, you must be willing to pursue a new mind. If you are comfortable with where you are, this isn't for you. But this is for those of us who say, hey, I want a new me. I'm tired of living the way I've been living in some areas. I want to be different. And here's what Paul is saying to us. If you want to become a new you, you must be willing to pursue, to go after, to chase a new mind. Here's another scripture. Philippians 2 and 5 says, let this mind be in who? In you, which is also in Christ Jesus. He was saying, don't just have the morals of Christ, right? Don't just have the morals of Christ, but he says, go after the mind of Christ. Don't just look churchy, right? It's good coming to church, singing in the choir, ushering on the usher ministry. It's good being a deacon, being a trustee. All of those hats that you wear are great. Those are services to the kingdom of God. Those are things that you do. But he says, if you really want to make a difference in your life and be all that God has called you to do and be, don't just have the morals of Christ, but go after the mind of Christ, which means it's not just about talking like Christ, but it's about thinking like Christ. You can have all the church cliches. You can say all of the amazing things that come with the church, because we know how to do church, right? We know how to do church, but yet we'll leave church and our lives are still jacked up. Why? Because we can talk church and talk Christ, but we haven't learned how to think Christ. Because if you've been in church long enough and you've been in church for a while, you've learned church language. But it's not about a language. It's about a new life. It's about a new start. It's about a new mind. If you want to go ahead in life, it starts with your head first. The changing of your mind will create new practices. The changing of your mind will create new patterns. The changing of your mind will create new ways of living. The reality is, the mind is the central headquarters of the body. And your body will eventually do what the mind says. And the key to transforming your life and having a transformative life is having a renewed mind. Can I tell you, and just for a moment, just for a point of contact as a preaching moment, and tell you that when you change your mind, your relationships begin to change. When you change your mind, your finances begin to change. When you change your mind, your business begins to change. When you change your mind, your family life begins to change. Everything starts with your mind. And the reality is, many of us have good practices in life and in church, but yet and still, we have not done the starting point of changing the mind. Are y'all with me on tonight? So, what does it mean, Paz, to renew or change your mind? Good. I'm glad you asked. Here's the reality. Changing your mind means to change your mindset. It's not enough just to think good. It's not enough to even have godly practices in your life. There has to be a rebooting of what you've been taught, or even what you believe with consciously, whether it's consciously or subconsciously. Because some of us, hear me, have inherited some mindsets. Some of us have inherited certain mindsets. What do you mean, Pastor? You don't just look and walk like your mama and your daddy. Some of us think like them. Let me say it again. So you don't just look. You know how people say, man, you look just like your mama. You look just like your daddy, right? And that's good. But there are also some things that you have inherited when it comes to your thinking that is connected to your mama and your daddy. And some of those mindsets, I don't want to be judgmental, but some of those mindsets have helped us in life, have helped us to get to where we are. There are some things that mama and daddy taught us that have been beneficial and helpful to our life. But then there are some mindsets and some ways of thinking that have hindered us in life. But here's what's amazing. Our history doesn't have to define our destiny. Our history doesn't have to define our destiny, and our past doesn't have to determine our future. Whatever you didn't get from your earthly father, you can get from God. you know the story, right? Moses went from a murderer to a what? To a deliverer. Why? Because he changed his mindset. He grew up in Pharaoh's house, and that's what he knew. But once he connected with God, his life, his mindset began to change. Okay, Moses may not be a good enough example. Peter, he goes from being a fisherman to being a fisherman of men. He goes from catching fish to now catching souls for Christ. So he goes from a fisherman to a preacher. All right, maybe that's not good enough. David went from being in the back of the house to being over a whole nation. He went from taking care of sheep at his father's house to now overseeing a whole nation for their future. What are you saying, Pat? I'm saying that God has a way of transforming us if we are willing to accept, acknowledge that we need to change our mindset and change our thinking. Moses would have still been where he was if he had not have changed his thinking. Paul would have still been where he was if he had not have changed his thinking. Peter would have still been where he was if he had not have changed his thinking. Right? It's all about your change in your mindset. If anything in your thinking is going to change, it's going to have to start with you. And I'm here to tell you that if anything in your thinking doesn't line with the vision that God has for you, you must change it in order to free your mind. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know what's in your thought process right now. I don't know what you've been thinking on lately. I don't know what your history looks like, but I'm here to tell you on today, God wants to free your mind. God wants to change your way of thinking. God wants to set things up in your life where you are able to set things up for your future, but it starts with your mind. Let's look at if you can go with me to the book of Romans, right? Go with me to Romans chapter number 8 and verse number 6. Right? Here's what it says. It says, for to be carnally minded is death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Did you hear that? Let me say it one more time. For to be carnally minded is death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace, because the carnal mind goes against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. But they that are in the flesh cannot please God. I'm trying to help us to understand on tonight. And this is just our introduction of where we're going. But here Paul is addressing two sets of thinking. The mindset of the flesh leads to death. And the mindset of the spirit leads to life and peace. So let me take the next few moments before we close and just begin to break a little bit of this down, and then we'll go a little bit deeper on next week. The carnality or the fleshly person, because we've got to look at the difference between fleshly and carnality versus spiritual. The carnality or fleshly person caters to the appetite and impulse of his or her desires. But the spiritual person gives their thinking over to the Holy Spirit. And the one that is carnal, their thinking leads to death. And the one that is spiritual, thinking leads to life and peace. Now, what's important is to understand is that here in Romans, Paul, don't miss this, as he's talking, he's not talking to non-believers. Okay? He's not talking to non-believers. Paul is writing to those who have accepted Jesus Christ in their life, which means, going back, that you can be saved and still not have your mind renewed. Okay. Did you hear what I said? I want you to catch this, because a lot of times we think that only the unsaved have carnal mentalities. But here Paul is showing us that you can be saved, love God, sing in the choir, serve in ministry, all of that, and still have a way of thinking that can lead you to death. Okay. You can be saved and still not have a renewed mind, because you can have a new heart and not have a new renewed mind. You can be born again and become a new person in Christ and still have the same mindset. I'm trying to get us to understand that sometimes it takes time and teaching for people to change their thinking. Are you with me? Whenever we allow our emotions and our flesh to control that which we are thinking, it will lead us to destruction because our bodies will eventually do what our minds say. When your spirit doesn't govern or lead your thinking, it means you will lead or end up in a place of destruction. Our minds have to be renewed. What are you saying? I'm saying you might be a good person, but if your life is governed by negative thoughts, if your life is governed by fear, if your life is governed by jealousy, if your life is governed by unforgiveness, if your life is governed by judgment, you can be a good person but living a miserable life because you haven't renewed your mind. It's hard to be happy. It's hard to be whole. It's hard to live a healthy life when your mind is so focused on worry and negativity and bitterness. That's why a lot of you can't sleep at night. Why? Because you're saved, but your mind hasn't been renewed. Now, I know, don't get it wrong. Don't get it twisted. I'm not saying that we don't have moments when things come in our lives and makes us, and it sometimes allows us to be in a place where we think bad or we begin to think negatively about something. It happens with all of us, but we should never allow those things to control us to a point that we stay stuck in a place that God never wanted us to be in. We don't have to allow what's a part of our lives to consume our lives. I'm saying, I might be frustrated today, but frustration doesn't have to consume or take over my life. I might be upset about something today. I might be angry about something that happens in my life, but those things and those emotions, those feelings don't have to control me. I might be overwhelmed, but it doesn't have to cause me to walk around in defeat. I might be fearful about something that's taking place, but I don't have to allow fear to trump my faith in God. And that's really where Satan desires for us to be. He wants us to be in a place where we misunderstand who God is in our life. He wants us to miss out on the true blessings that God has for us. Look at John 8 and 44. Then we get ready to close, right? He says, "Yea, are you of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning." He abandoned the truth because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh, he's a liar. When he speaketh, he is of his own accord. If he is a liar and the father of it, we got to understand who Satan is. So he will keep allowing you and I to live in the mindset of alternative facts instead of walking in faith, because he can't tell the truth. You and I both have to start declaring over our mindsets that whatever Satan has said about us, whatever he has said about our family, I will not be defeated. I will not be a failure. I am not a mistake. My past does not dictate my future. I'm not what my history is, but rather I'm a child of God and I live in destiny. I am what God says that I am. My life is next. My family is blessed. My future is bright. And you've got to be able to say those things to yourself in your mind in order to create the mind that God and the life that God has for you. We'll pick up again on next week. Let's pray. Father, thank you on tonight for reminding us, God, that you are grace, that you are the one who in fact was there from the beginning, and you sent your son Jesus to in fact be the perpetuator of our sins, and the one who in fact wraps his loving arms around us, and who is never absent or ever will ever walk in a place of abandonment to us. Help us, God, to renew our thinking. Renew our mind. Help us, God, to be who God has called us to be. We'll be so careful to give your name glory, praise, and honor. It is in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I love you, family, and we'll see you on next week. God bless you.